Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Black Indians, A Hidden Heritage by William Loren Katz. Narrated by Bill Andrew Quinn. To friends Jean Carey Bond, Osceola Townsend, George Tooks, Pompey Fixico, and Woody Strode, and their heroic ancestors, the heroes of this book, and to Kenneth Wiggins Porter, forerunner, scholar, mentor, who embraced the creed lived by Wildcat and John Horse. Love of people and resistance to tyranny. W.L.K. The European is to other races of mankind what man himself is to the lower animals. He makes them subservient to his use, and when he cannot subdue, he destroys them. Alexis de Tocqueville, Democracy in America, 1835. One of the longest unwritten chapters in the history of the United States is that treating of the relations of the Negroes and the Indians. The Indians were already here when the white men came, and the Negroes brought in soon after to serve as a subject race found among the Indians one of their means of escape. Carter G. Woodson, Journal of Negro History, 1920. In the course of time, the American people got into Florida and began to live. This caused trouble. The colored people and the Indians, being natives of the land, naturally went on the war path. They fought until the American people called for peace. The Indians and the Negroes gave them peace. Joe Phillips, Black Seminole, 1930. Preface to the 25th Anniversary Edition. When Black Indians appeared a quarter of a century ago, it was ignored by the mainstream media, but triggered immediate, full-throated, multi-layered, and louder public responses than my 40 other books. It won no prizes, but was hawked by street booksellers in Manhattan from 8th Street and 6th Avenue to 125th Street and in other cities. However, for white people, the book's title and cover immediately stirred controversy that still continues to this day. So many expressed annoyance with the title, I wondered if any bothered to open the book. While reading it on New York subways, WLIB radio talk show host Imhotep Gary Bird was confronted by white writers who pointed to the cover and title and heatedly said, "There were not." When his son brought a copy to a social studies teacher, he met, "Oh, come on," disbelief. Some reacted negatively before the book appeared. One New York Native American nation denied me permission to use a 1940s group photo of their members in a book entitled Black Indians. When I showed this picture to an African American friend, he recognized his uncle and then identified half of the other figures as descended from Africans. Some responses were far from painless. After some university and museum lectures, students of color approached me in tears. A young woman at John Jay College said, "I never knew any of this." Rather than seeing a historical cover-up, she blamed herself. At New York's American Museum of Natural History, a young woman plaintively asked, "Why weren't we taught anything about this?" I heard hundreds of rhetorical or angry variations of this question. In 1906, Booker T. Washington visited Oklahoma and was astounded by the racial mix of whites, African Americans, and Native Americans. The whole situation out here is complicated and puzzling, and if one attempts to understand it, he is very deep into the intricacies of a social and political history so full of surprises that it reminds him of Alice in Wonderland. In 1986, Black Indians drew Alice in Wonderland reactions. One scholar spent a lengthy essay debating the book's title and concluded it should be Indian Blacks. An African-American critic approvingly quoted and cited Black Indians over and over again and declared it the most progressive scholarship by white people. In the age of Howard Zinn, that would amount to high praise. But in the same sentence, the critic states this kind of scholarship usually reflects a white supremacist standpoint. Odd, mixed or confusing reactions continued. Rudy, a young Native American friend without African ancestry, revealed how he and his friends asked their organization to sponsor a book party for Black Indians, and the elders refused. He handed me documents showing that they were influenced by a white scholar who compared my racial thinking to that of Adolf Hitler. Rudy's Native American Society invited me to a meeting, and his officers asked if I was a troublemaker. However, when invited back months later, I found a warm meeting of the minds and saw staff members of mixed descent. Based on past experiences, Native American groups had reason to fear that the Bureau of Indian Affairs might try to use my research as an excuse to reduce allotments or other aid. But in a short while, most Native Americans and societies reaffirmed their commitment to all their members. Black Indians began with an enthusiastic book party at the Schomburg Center for Research in Black History and Culture that included 8 Black Indian speakers. African American reviewers eagerly greeted the book, though some added they wanted more information than its 200 pages provided. I was invited to share stories at Black Indian spiritual meetings in the New York area, to appear on African American and Native American media programs, and was stopped on the street by people of color who had something to say. Jim Buck, who was a Native American producer at a national public radio station, used the book and my contacts to develop 2-hour-long documentaries. And an invitation from the editor of Brooklyn's Daily Challenge led to my writing an unpaid op-ed column for the next 22 years. Bob Law of WWRL repeatedly interviewed me on his night talk, as did Imhotep Gary Bird on WLIB's The Global Black Experience. Gary Bird asked me to serve as a co-host on WLIB's Columbus Day broadcasts along with Cecilia Fire Thunder of KILI, the Pine Ridge Reservation's Native American radio station. Our Columbus Day efforts raised 1/4 of KILI's annual budget. Responses from the Black Indian community were warm and fulsome. In 1989, the National Alliance of Native Americans Longhouse made me an honorary member, and in 2000, for Fostering Understanding Between Peoples of Native American and African Americans Descent, I became the first recipient of Ohio's White Dove Peace Award. Native American and African American Studies departments on more than a few college campuses united to sponsor my presentations. And I was invited to address a protest rally in front of New York's American Museum of Natural History. Artists unknown and well-known, white and people of color, painters, novelists, actors, writers, sculptors, and poets, responded to the book through their media. People sent along sketches, paintings, poems, books, and movie ideas. The African Apache Cherokee songwriting team of Lingotooks composed Black Indian Woman in its honor. In 1990, at the Brooklyn Academy of Music, Abdel Salam staged a ballet, P.D. River Bonding, about the 1526 Black Indian colony in South Carolina, and it had the audience cheering and leaping to its feet, noted the New York Times critic. I had exciting arguments and made many friends. The 1986 preface to the Black Indians expressed my hope that it would lead to further investigation and synthesis. I never expected the startling level of scholarly reactions. In 2002, at Dartmouth College, and in 2007, at the University of Kansas, hundreds of scholars and activists assembled in national conferences to discuss what had become the new field of Black Indian studies. Alice Walker's Towering the Temple of My Familiar devoted a chapter to the intrepid African and Seminole alliance that weaved its way from Florida to Oklahoma to Mexico and back to Texas. When her husband, Suelo, gives Fanny, Walker's leading character, a copy of Black Indians for her birthday, she becomes enthralled with the spirited Seminoles, Wildcat and John Horse. After she finishes the book, he asks her, "What do you love about these people?" Fanny answers, "I don't know," she said. "They open doors inside me. It's as if they're keys to rooms inside myself. I find a door inside, and it's as if I hear a humming from behind it, and then I get inside somehow with the key the old ones give me, and as I stumble about in the darkness of the room, I begin to feel the stirring in myself, the humming of the room, and my heart starts to expand with the absolute feeling of bravery, or love, or audacity, or commitment. It becomes a light, and that light enters me by osmosis, and a part of me that was not clear before is clarified. I radiate this expanded light, happiness. And that, Suwelo knew, was called being in love. In 1819, at the Congress of Angostura, liberator Simón Bolívar was elected president of Venezuela and planned a strategy that would free the Americas of foreign domination. He also found it necessary to clarify the racial birthright of the Americas. The larger part of the native population has disappeared. Europeans have mixed with the Indians and the Negroes, and Negroes have mixed with the Indians. We were all born of one mother America, though our fathers had different origins, and we all have differently colored skins. This dissimilarity is of the greatest significance. Almost two centuries after Simón Bolívar's great truth, I am humbled by the creative use of my research and deeply moved by the love readers have shown the courageous men and women who inhabit this book. It is a pleasure and an honor to offer this revised edition of Black Indians. This story is no longer hidden. I hope new readers will be interested to meet these valiant Americans and hear their epic stories as I was to look into their lives. These men and women have earned an honored place in our history and cherished memories. William Loren Katz, June 2011. Introduction. Black Indians? The very words make most people shake their heads in disbelief or smile at what appears to be a joke, a play on words. No one remembers any such person in a school text, history book, or Western novel. None ever appeared. Yet they lived and roamed all over the Americas. Their story began with the first European landings in the New World, reached from New England to Brazil, and continues today. The number of African Americans with an Indian ancestor was once estimated at about one-third of the total. In Latin America, the percentage is much higher. This means that an important page in history has been missing. Three great races, red, white, and black, built the Americas together. Their contributions and their interrelationships have filled libraries with scholarly studies, history texts, and novels. The relationship between Europeans and Native Americans and between Europeans and Africans have been thoroughly studied, but one relationship has not. Conspicuous by its neglect is the relationship on this soil between red and black people. In 1920, historian Carter G. Woodson called it one of the longest unwritten chapters in the history of the United States. He wondered if Africans did not find among Indians one of their means to escape from slavery. Dr. Woodson's chapter still remains unwritten, his escape theory hardly explored. This book means to tackle both the chapter and the theory. Black Indians, like other African Americans, have been treated by the writers of history as invisible. Their contributions were denied or handed to others. Where mentioned, their role has been distorted. For example, The Negro Cowboys by Durham and Jones, an otherwise objective study, calls black people who joined the Indians renegades, a terrifying term borrowed from Hollywood westerns to describe vicious killers. The Negro Cowboys also declares, for every Negro renegade who joined against the white man, a company of Negro soldiers fought the Indians. This single sentence mangles some important history. It understates the number of black Indians by hundreds of thousands. It also suggests slaves should remain loyal to their owners and praises those who fought the Indians. It is not that U.S. chroniclers of the past have failed to see a black Indian heritage through the eyes of people of color, for that is understandable. Almost all were white. What is unforgivable is that some have insisted on seeing past events through the eyes of a slaveholding and Indian-killing class that has been dead for more than a century. But omission, not distortion, is the far more serious culprit in hiding the story of the black Indians of the Americas. Observers, not expecting to find Africans among Indians, did not report their presence. For example, artist George Catlin painted a magnificent portrait of Chief Osceola when he and other Seminoles were held captive at Fort Moultrie in 1837. Catlin never painted or mentioned that Osceola's personal bodyguard of 55 warriors included 52 black Seminoles. Had his artistry captured their presence, he would have contributed vastly to our understanding of anthropology and history. I have some empathy for this blindness. During research for my book, The Black West, I kept unearthing frontier documents and photographs that established a significant Black Indian presence on the U.S. frontier. I never fully weighed my evidence, and the Black West gave Black Indians minor attention until the third edition. As my private collection of Indian photographs and documentation piled up, it became clear the subject needed fuller treatment. Though it is unfamiliar terrain, I have chosen to begin this story at the beginning, with the earliest foreign landings in the Western Hemisphere. This has two advantages. It establishes a Black Indian participation in democratic movements, years, decades, or centuries before the American Revolution. It also demonstrates that dark people ignored the boundaries drawn by Europeans in their move from one country to another in search of liberty, justice, or a better life. This unknown American story is deeply rooted in the human currents that shaped our early life. Two parallel institutions joined to create Black Indians: the seizure and mistreatment of Indians and their lands, and the enslavement of Africans. In their conquest of the New World, Europeans were determined to use both dark peoples. 10 whites are not enough to watch one Negro, said a Portuguese slave master living in Brazil in 1735. To protect slavery and prevent resistance, Europeans developed brutal methods of control and degrading racial policies. There is evidence that European genocidal attacks on Indians in the New World may have an additional explanation besides land hunger and greed. Perhaps another reason for eliminating Indians was to prevent their alliance with Africans. Colonial Europeans left evidence aplenty that this was often an overriding fear. Research into early American history confronts one with some inaccurate traditional assumptions and vocabulary. Columbus, believing he had landed in the East Indies, called the inhabitants Indians. His error has become so much a part of our language that today even many Native Americans accept it. I have used both designations. However, I have dropped such derisive terms as half-breed, renegade, and tribe in characterizing Native Americans and Africans. If Europeans came from nations, so too did people of color. I have defined Black Indians as people who have a dual ancestry or Black people who have lived for some time with Native Americans. When slaves escaped to the woods and joined or began remote communities, they are called by the Spanish term Maroons. In discussing the time when most foreigners in the Americas came from either Europe or Africa, I have used such words as Spaniard or African. When it is clear they were born in the Western Hemisphere, I then use such terms as white, black, or African American. I have not designated only U.S. citizens as Americans, for that broad category belongs to all people of the Americas. Despite their bias, I have had no choice but to accept Latin America, British colonies, and American Revolution, because other phrases would prove cumbersome or unclear. I have been humbled by the awesome task of rejecting bias in so explosively controversial a topic and one peopled with so stormy a set of characters. In this story, even the simple question of criminality is open to interpretation. Were those who escaped slavery seeking freedom or breaking the law? Were Black Indian Maroon settlements havens of self-determination or conspiracies against the European state? One solution I have adopted has been to offer eyewitness accounts and to see that the neglected views of Africans and Native Americans are presented. I have never sought a bland neutrality and have consoled myself that unbiased history has yet to be written in our world. This is a labor of love that has introduced me to many exciting Americans it would have been interesting to meet. I have tried hard to balance opinions, present contrasting views, manage personal feelings, and uncover some truths. This is a subject that deserves further investigation and synthesis. Clearly, people and events described in one chapter, or even a part of one, deserve far greater study. If this effort contributes to those ends, a personal goal will have been reached. William Loren Katz. 1. If you know I have a history. Today, most Black Indians do not live in the forests or on the broad plains of the United States. Most do not inhabit government reservations set aside for Native Americans any more than most Indians do. To be sure, they crowd, for example, the Shinnecock Reservation on New York's Long Island, but many more walk the crowded streets of nearby New York City. They are found in abundance in the cement caverns of Boston, Chicago, Denver, Cleveland, and Detroit. They have made a long march from farms, woods, and ranches to skyscrapers, subways, and ghettos. Most have arrived with only a faint recollection of their adventurous rural heritage and gallant ancestors. The people they meet in schools, at work, or play cannot appreciate their background because they know nothing about it. "If you know I have a history, you will respect me," a Black Indian student told a conference of New York teachers in 1968. Her words still ring true. Those who assume that a people have no history worth mentioning are likely to believe they have no humanity worth defending. An historical legacy strengthens a country and its people. Denying a people's heritage questions their legitimacy. Citizens celebrate this country's daring break from colonial rule and rejoice in the plucky Minutemen who challenged the British at Lexington and Concord. But a month before those historic skirmishes on the path to freedom, other Americans were pursuing the same goal. Slaves in Ulster County, New York, planned a massive armed rising. Perhaps they had heard the exciting patriotic talk about liberty and independence. Their liberation plot involved slaves in Kingston, Hurley, Marbletown, and upwards of 500 Native Americans. Unlike the Minutemen, their shot was not heard around the world. Their bold conspiracy never found its way into our history books. These dark people in Ulster County, like thousands of others mentioned in this book, made their contribution to freedom and to their immediate relatives and friends. But other Black Indians made a contribution to the entire U.S. society that deserves consideration. On the snowy night of March 5, 1770, Crispus Attucks, a Black Natick Indian, stepped dramatically into U.S. history in Boston. He was the first to fall in the Boston Massacre. Benson J. Lossing, a 19th-century historian, transformed Attucks into a Nantucket Indian. To Lossing, it seemed wrong to place an African-American with Native American blood at the daring first moment of American independence. Paul Cuffey, a Dartmouth Indian with African parentage, became a wealthy merchant and ship owner in early Massachusetts. He married Alice Pequot of his mother's Wampanoag Nation. But his great interest was in protecting fellow African-Americans from discrimination in the United States, and he became the first Black man to sponsor a migration of U.S. Blacks to Africa. In 1815, he personally paid for and led 38 settlers aboard his ship, Traveler, to Sierra Leone. Cuffey became the father of Black back-to-Africa movements in this country. Frederick Douglass, a slave runaway with mixed African, Indian, and white ancestry, became the leading voice of Black America during the Civil War era and the decades that followed. His creed, "If there is no struggle, there is no progress," has inspired reform and revolutionary movements ever since. Douglass's name and accomplishments now adorn most history texts. Langston Hughes, poet laureate of African Americans, liked to trace his family tree back to Pocahontas. In that tree also was a man who joined John Brown's famous raid on Harper's Ferry and another who became a Virginia congressman. Hughes, a prolific writer of poetry, plays, short stories, novels, autobiographies, and newspaper columns, became the proud voice of Harlem, New York's Black community. In the early centuries of their life in the Americas, Black Indians often created a society that might have been a model for everyone. They demonstrated that there was another path through the wilderness than the one hacked out by a European lust for gold, land, and power. Their communities proved bigotry did not rise naturally from American soil, its plains and waters. Bigotry and the appetite for it were imported. They traveled the stormy Atlantic and were speedily transplanted and nourished by those who carried them over. If they had been of a mind to, Europeans might have learned something from the dark people they selfishly used. Instead, they gathered these people's precious gifts and offered promises in return. Africans and Indians followed a tradition that rarely wrote matters down, but held to verbal promises. Europeans wrote many, many things down, but failed to keep to their promises or treaties. What followed in the New World was a titanic European battle for the control of dark people and natural resources. Europe marched out its best soldiers to secure a continent and subdue its people. The result was unending conquest and agonizing slavery. But beyond the pain were armed Black Indian communities named Hide Me and The Woods Lament for Me. They were home for some of our earliest explorers and pioneers. Families brought up their young, constructed homes, planted and harvested crops, took care of their elderly. They traded with neighbors, instituted religion, government, justice, and planned the common defense. These settlements not only provided women with an equality and respect unheard of in European society, but elevated some to leadership. Two colonial Brazilian Black Indian communities were commanded by African women, and another African Maroon settlement in 1826 in Brazil was ruled by a Black woman named Zeferina, who successfully led her forces against towns and plantations in Bahia. With few weapons, these alliances in the woods challenged the footholds Europeans built in the Western Hemisphere. Using guerrilla tactics that would become famous in China and Vietnam in our own century, Red and Black people defeated superior numbers and better-equipped foreign armies. This they managed while moving their families out of harm's way. These dark liberators often proved that European rule in the Americas amounted to a thin coat of white paint over a seething dark empire. Before Patrick Henry shouted, "Give me liberty or give me death," Black Indian Maroons acted on this notion. Before Thomas Jefferson wrote, "All men are created equal," Black Indians turned a stirring phrase into hard reality. Before the Declaration of Independence eloquently argued for a people's revolution against unjust authority, thousands of dark-skinned Americans had been fighting tyrants and slave hunters on two continents. For their audacity, Black Indians faced a repression more ruthlessly cruel than any King George III imposed on the 13 original colonies. They were forced to carry on the longest, bloodiest battle for freedom in the Western Hemisphere. Repeatedly, they persuaded Europeans it was wiser to grant them independence, sovereignty, and liberty than to continue wars. European powers often learned this lesson late, after they had wasted lives and fortunes on the idea that these free colonies could be easily destroyed. Maroon wars outlasted the endless conflicts between rival European states. Neither side gave nor asked any quarter, and prisoners were few. For their part, Maroons, even when captured and facing a terrible death, tried to protect their villagers. More than a century ago, a British report from Belém, Brazil, described how a captured Negro gave such an account of the difficulties and dangers of the journey to a settlement that 33 out of the 40 foreign soldiers refused to accompany their captain. To prevent Africans and Native Americans from uniting, Europeans played skillfully on racial differences and ethnic rivalries. They kept the pot of animosity boiling. Whites turned Indians into slave hunters and slave owners, and Africans into Indian fighters. Light-skinned Africans were pitted against dark-skinned, free against enslaved, Black Indians against pure Africans or pure Indians. Those who have put history into books have emphasized differences between Africans and Native Americans. For example, they have stressed that Europeans encountered Indians as distinct individuals and members of proud nations, and Africans as nameless slaves. Little mention is made of the enslavement of Native Americans, and nothing is said about the cultural similarities between the two dark peoples. In 1984, scholar Theda Perdue said, "By emphasizing the actual, exaggerated, and imagined differences between Africans and Indians, whites successfully masked the cultural similarities of the two races as well as their mutual exploitation by whites." In the United States, Africans became central in the exploration of the new nation and the development of the crucial fur trade. Because they were more able to build a binding trust among Native Americans, whites employed them as negotiators, and they did not disappoint. Africans, like Native Americans, cherished their own trustworthiness and saw promises and treaties as bonds never to be broken. In the 19th century, a Black Indian friendship limped on despite onslaughts from white racial policies destructive to both peoples. It survives still in the legends of Native American nations and in the stories and faces of many people of color. Frontier Myth and Reality. Generations of young minds have been trained to think of life on the American frontier as a saga of white gallantry. Daring pioneers probed the wilderness. John Wayne cowboys whipped Indians to give us the USA. Children of every race rejoiced in this version of the frontier served up each Saturday afternoon at the movies. In the real wilderness, two dark people met and often united. They were not driven together by any special affinity based on a similar skin color. Their meetings were unwittingly arranged by their enemies, the Europeans, who exploited both. But in the retelling of our Western history, no one learned that Africans and Native Americans, separately and together, fought bravely for an American they knew was also theirs. Perhaps their story was trampled underfoot by their hard-riding European foes. In 1774, Patriot James Madison wrote about a slave revolt. It is prudent such attempts should be concealed as well as suppressed. The Black Indian story has been treated as though it were a massive slave rebellion. Its final burial came at the hands of a later white generation who shaped a heritage for books and movies that ended all claims but European ones. These frontier omissions lie at the heart of our cherished national myth. The tale of the wilderness stands as the greatest American story ever told. It is the way we wish to see ourselves. A frontier people, said President Woodrow Wilson, is, so far, the central and determining fact of our national history. The West is the great word for our history. The Westerner has been the type and master of our American life. Creators of this West did not want it sullied by an African presence or subject to Indian claims. The frontier went from gritty reality to uplifting truth and finally to national legend. In the process, entire races disappeared from view. Its cast of heroic characters included only whites. If Europeans bravely conquered continents, it was not necessary or desirable to show black and red people defying white authority to build their own communities in the wilderness. Racial stereotypes long pictured people of color as cowardly or childlike. How could red or black people be shown creating a culture in the wilderness, bravely rescuing their families and riding off into the sunset? There is another problem in introducing a set of dark frontier heroes. Their love of liberty thrust them against some sainted U.S. figures. Thomas Jefferson, speaking of Indians, said, "We would never stop pursuing them with war while one remained on the face of the earth." Andrew Jackson, the first great Democrat to reach the White House, was first in a long line of candidates to win the presidency, boasting of his Indian fighting skills. He waged a cruel war against Indian men, women, and children. He staunchly defended slavery and, like Jefferson, owned slaves. To save their families, black Indians had to fight off posses and armies launched by these national heroes. Distorting racial history, as teachers know, injures dark children. They live with a muted heritage. Despite black Indian contributions to this land, neither black nor Indian children nor their parents have an awareness of this legacy. Like whites, Native Americans learned in school that Africans were contented slaves and had no fighting traditions, certainly none that allied them with Indians. For their part, African Americans are aware of Indians in their family trees, but they probably assume that, like the whites lurking there, they are mere intruders. Such inaccurate beliefs hide a heritage worth exploring. Further, they divide people today who would benefit from the unity forged by their ancestors. When African Americans have pursued their genealogy, they have focused on their African roots and sought a meaningful black heritage. Children of the black awareness of the 1960s have rarely cared to mention an Indian ancestry because this might be seen as a denial of their African origins and the value of blackness. All this is part of the racial nightmare we have inherited. With her usual perception, precision, and pride, Rosa Fay, a black Seminole living in Brackettville, Texas in 1943, clarified her people's background for pioneer researcher Kenneth W. Porter. "We's colored people. I don't say we don't has no Injun blood, 'cause we has, but we ain't no Injuns. We's colored people." Other Americans would benefit from a re-examination of their family trees and a new look at their biological inheritance. The process may yield wonder and gratification where once grief or skepticism ruled. The ancestors of Black Indians often created, or died in the attempt, an American sisterhood and brotherhood we have tried to attain. They did this under terrible circumstances and in the face of armed opposition. Had we paid proper attention to their unique model of friendship and loyalty, our common American history, from Hudson Bay to Cape Horn, might have been different, more peaceful. Our racial problems might have been more easily solved. Even at this late date, we owe ourselves a rereading of this fascinating legacy. Perhaps we can still learn from and act on its lessons. 2. They fled amongst the Indians. On July 13, 1984, the people of Roanoke Island, North Carolina, their names emblazoned on books, T-shirts, and silver commemorative medallions, began a year-long celebration. It is their proud claim that U.S. history began with a British settlement on their island. Cultural events throughout the state announced.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.